Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Dan. The pleasure to start this session. I hope you can all understand me, and I'm not standing in front of the screen. I'm afraid I do for this part of the room, so I'll try to move a bit at times so that you can actually still see what I'm presenting there. I'll talk a little bit about a study that we did about differential climate impacts between 1.5 and 2 degrees that we published in Earth System Dynamics earlier this year, and I'll talk you through some of the key findings from this one and actually how we achieved that. So next one, please. So we really did, as I said, a targeted analysis, not really running new modeling results, but basically reanalyzing CMIP-5 and ESMIP data with this particular question of how to discriminate between 1.5 and 2, and we used about 11 different indicators, extreme events, as well as some key indicators from the impact modeling side to compare these two, as well as coral reefs and sea level rise, which I'll also comment on a bit later. Next one, please. So yeah, what we did is we applied time slicing methods to actually arrive at a 1.5 and a 2 degree time slice, so to say. There's obviously different approaches how you can derive impacts at different levels of warming, and this is the one that we used. So why we chose that and we used it in a model selective time model selective manner is there's obviously a large variation in transient climate response between the climate models. So if you would just basically take an average time period for each for around the 2040s or 2050s, for example, you would actually have quite a spread in the global mean temperature response, which would dilute your impact signal as well. So if you press the next one, please. So this is from the RCP 8.5 that we actually used. This is a range for the 5 to 95% range of CMIP-5 models where they would actually, in a running mean, cross the 1.5 or 2 degree threshold. So you can see that there's, first of all, quite an overlap, but also there's quite a range in terms of years. So we did this model specific, so if you selected for each of the individual models that we looked into, the 20 years where they have a mean warming of 20 years. So this of 1.5 and 2 degrees, sorry for that. So this is the first step that we did to basically reduce our uncertainties in a sense to discriminate better between 1.5 and 2. Next one, please. The second is that we applied a method of regional aggregation for signals which are subject to substantial natural variability. This is a method that was developed by Erich Fischer at the ETH to discriminate between different warming levels and observations for extreme events, and we applied this also here in this context. So what we do is basically we do a 20-year average on the grid scale level, then aggregate regionally or over the global landmass, and then arriving at different distributions for these individual models. And what this allows us to do, and this is probably an important feature as well, we can now compare the characteristics of a 1.5 degree distribution that we have in regional aggregation and a 2 degree distribution and can say something if they are statistically significantly different. And obviously we have talked a lot about uncertainty and how to discriminate between 1.5 and 2, and we find that this probably is an important element of really saying something robust, because in this uncertainty that we are talking about, we will have different elements. We will have a stochastic uncertainty component that is inherent to the climate system, and yes, we probably can't say much about that one. But we will also have a systemic uncertainty that stems from different climate models having certain biases or different projections, and we can still say something about this uncertainty by saying, is there a difference on an individual model basis between 1.5 and 2, although we may have a substantial overlap in the model ensemble projections. So to accounting for that, this is what we did, and then we arrived, sorry, please one back, and then we arrived with some cumulative density functions like this one. So this is just an illustrative example of what we did. So there's the land area on the y-axis and the relative change in this case for the consecutive dry days relative to the 1986 to 2005 period. And in gray, it is the CDF that you would expect from natural variability alone. And in blue, it's for 1.5 degrees time slices. And in red, it's for 2 degrees. And you would see that for the median land area, so for 50% of the land area, there's not much difference in this CDD index, which is in line with our understanding that for a large part of the land area, we won't see something robust for drying trends. But what you also see is that for the upper end, so for about 25%, 20% of the global land area, there actually is a change between now and 1.5, and also between 1.5 and 2. And the question is, can we look into detail and can we basically say where that is and say something more concrete about the regional differences between 1.5 and 2? And this is pretty much what we did. So next slide, please. We did use the SREX world regions and derived these CDFs for all of these regions to discriminate on the regional level the signal differences between 1.5 and 2. Next one, please. And there you can find hotspots of change. So this is now the same figure, not for the global land area, but for the Mediterranean. And there you see there's a robust difference between the observational record 1.5 and 2. So for the Mediterranean, we can say, OK, there is an evidence that there is a robust drying signal. And we know this from other climate predictions, so it's nothing too surprising. But it helps us to discriminate and say something more more distinct about also the differences between 1.5 and 2. Next one, please. Another thing that you can learn from these graphs, although it is certainly not the best methodology to do that, is you can look at how much of the land area would actually experience some of these indicators that are would be very unlikely under the currently under just natural variations. So if you go up there and you say, okay, what's the threshold, what would be unprecedented over the reference period based on what the methodological approach we applied, you'll find that about 5% of the Mediterranean land area would experience annual dry events that would fall in this very unlikely regime under just the recent past. And this number increases strongly under 2 degrees, so it's about 20%. As I said, that's probably not the methodological approach you would like to apply if you really want to discuss unprecedented extreme events, but it gives you some indication about the level of change that you are expecting there. Next one, please. So we summarize this, for a range of indicators. So to the very top now, this is heat wave duration index. So this is kind of gives an indication for warm spell length. And for the global land area, we would have about 1 month under such conditions on average for 1.5 and about 1.5 months for 2 degrees. This can be substantially higher in tropical regions where the natural variability is lower, and this will affect then how our indicator will play out. And this is in line with other studies who also say that on a 2-degree warming, you would, tropical Africa, for example, you would look into summers that would be equivalent to today's unprecedented heat waves. So due to this natural variability, you're really pushing tropical regions where there's less natural variability into a kind of a new climatic regime. We also then looked into EASYMIP indicators. So the next one is annual water availability, total runoff that we got from the EASYMIP data. So it's not an extreme event indicator anymore. It's really total available water over the full year. And there, again, the Mediterranean sticks out with a particularly robust signal. And it's becoming even stronger there. So we'll have about 9% reduction under 1.5 degrees compared to the recent past. And this nearly doubles under 2 degrees. So there's the median projection is 17%. So again, this hotspot picture that we saw for drought in meteorological drought indicator is carried through the impact model, and it's even enhanced there. We also did this for extreme precipitation, and there the South Asian region sticks out with an above global increase in extreme precipitation between 1.5 and 2. Next one, please. Then we did it for global crop yields. Again, from the EASYMIP results, and those of you who've worked with crop yield predictions know that these are inherently uncertain, and it's very difficult to narrow them down because there's a lot of factors also that are represented very differently between these models. But nevertheless, there's a few things that you can learn from an analysis like this one. And one probably is that for some crop types in tropical regions, which is what we singled out here, and it's probably a bit difficult to see in the back, and I'm not going to talk you through all the numbers that are on this graph, unfortunately, but I can just point you to the paper, and I hope you just buy my conclusions that I'll draw from this right now, is that for tropical regions, for wheat and maize, there's a particular risk increase between 1.5 and 2, so you'll see a strong signal there. For wheat, it's -9% under 1.5 degrees, -16 median under 2 degrees, and for maize, it's -3 and -6, so it's in both cases a near doubling, although within a very, very large uncertainty band, so this is important to emphasize, and it's obviously crop type dependent, so for soy and maize, it would look different. Nevertheless, if you factor in uncertainties related to CO2 fertilization, the whole picture becomes even a bit more complex, and if you would exclude effects of CO2 fertilization, you would have strong negative effects on crop yields for all 4 major staple crops. Next one, please. As I said, we also moved beyond just land-based indicators and looked at sea level rise and coral reef loss. And for sea level rise, as these are inherently scenario-dependent signals, we used a stylized 1.5 degree and a stylized 2 degree scenario. Sorry, I forgot to put it up. And you would see for these two scenarios, you would see a sea level difference by the end of the century of about 10 centimeters between 1.5 and 2, which is already substantial, but more importantly is the rate of change. And this already differs by about 30% between 1.5 and 2, so with 1.5 degree scenario, the rate of change is comparable to what we currently observe. And this points towards a long-term legacy of sea level rise that these scenarios would entail, and this would be substantially higher under a 2-degree scenario where there's no slowdown in long-term sea level rise apparent over the 21st century. For coral reefs, and we've learned that today, the projections are particularly dire. So we learned that just this year, with the third global mass bleaching event, we lost 25% of the Great Barrier Reef, 90% of it was bleached, and 25% was probably permanently damaged. So the projections there are very unpleasant. So under a 2-degree scenario, virtually all global coral reefs would be affected by long-term degradation due to thermal stress alone. So there is very little prospect of any of these systems to survive. If you limit to 1.5 degrees, it's still a very high number. It's still at least 90%. And the question is there, how much of these systems would eventually be able to survive that? But at least there is some room open for ecosystem adaptation, hopefully. And we have could have some hope that this that we can deal with that. So for this particular sensitive ecosystem, this appears to be a very critical threshold. Next one, please.
Is there recovery between 2050 and 2100, or are those numbers?
There's no recovery in the model. It's basically in the 1.5 degree scenario, the temperatures are going down again. So this is the reason why you see this number. Thank you. We summarize this in a recent Nature Climate Change perspective, which also integrates elements from other publications that have spoken to 1.5 and 2 degrees. And this is basically a summary of most of the findings that I've just showed you, also pointing to its multiple annual sea level rise. So there to the lower end, there's some estimates for 2,000 years sea level rise under 1.5 and 2 degree warming. But I couldn't resist also following the discussions from today to put another figure from this perspective in there. So next one, please. Which is not directly related to the impacts here, but basically to the question of land use and bioenergy. So we had a long discussion about the particular relevance for 1.5 and 2. And what we looked into there is really what do the models tell us? What is the requirement for bioenergy in different scenarios from the IPCC database and from most recent 1.5 degree studies? So there's global mean temperature on the x-axis and bioenergy contribution to primary energy in 2050 to the left and in 2100 to the right. And what you see there is, yes, for 1.5 degree scenarios, you'll have substantially bioenergy contributions. But what you also see, you'll also have substantial bioenergy contributions for scenarios that arrive at much higher levels of warming, even up to 3 degrees. And if you go to 2100, which is the right side, there will be some scenarios out there with very high levels of bioenergy, and they're not at all near to 1.5 degrees. So the lower green bar is the sustainable technical range that has been identified in literature, and there's a higher green, the other green bar is medium agreement of a sustainable technical potential. So the conclusion from this is not as clear cut. It's one, the question of bioenergy and the effects on bioenergy on impacts is not a question of 1.5 degrees probably. Obviously, you have to rely on some level of negative emissions if you want to get to 1.5 degrees, so also to 2 degrees. So this is a question that needs to be addressed. But nevertheless, the current model scenarios that we have, they all feature bioenergy, or many of them, in one way or the other. So it's probably a problem that goes beyond that, and we should reflect that in our considerations of this issue, I think. With that, I want to conclude. So I talked a little bit about key differences and probably methodological approaches on tackling them and learning something about discrimination between 1.5 and 2. And in particularly, what we found is that there is a very different regional profile and how these impacts would play out. One region that I omitted, and I apologize for that, is the Arctic, because we didn't really study Arctic sea ice. But for example, Arctic sea ice is another system where we probably look into an ice-free Arctic somewhere between 1.5 and 2 degrees. We don't know that. The uncertainties are very large. But we know the sensitivity of these systems point towards the question whether or not we are there in this range of global mean temperature increase. And apart from that, our results reveal that it's particularly the tropical regions that bear the brunt of these differences. So for them, it matters particularly a lot if we avoid this additional level of warming. Thank you.
A comment and a question. The question is, where does this strong spatial heterogeneity come from? I mean, why did Mediterranean, for example, on Friday decrease?
Well, it's basically, we have an expansion of the subtropical dry zones. So we'll see that in other subtropical regions as well. So in the in Central America, in South Africa, and in Australia. It's just that the signal is particularly robust in the Mediterranean. The model agreement is very high. And it's, we also see this from the observational record, that this is a region where these projections are particularly strong in the conclusions.
The quick comment is that when you were looking at the ocean, you know, you were looking at the difference of 1.5 to 2 to one very specific stovepipe risk, right, which is temperature to corals.
Mm-hmm.
But when you look at the risk in the way that they actually compound each other as you go from 1.5 to 2 degrees, and what warming does to deoxygenation, and what it does to acidification, and everything that has to do with the act of warming from 1.5 to 2 degrees, you know, of course the impact becomes vastly larger.
Mm-hmm.
Not 25% larger, vastly larger. So just to plead to, we all need to start thinking about it in terms of strongly covariant levels of risk.
No, I couldn't agree more. I think it's key importance. It's just basically, and this is certainly not the end of our efforts to discriminate between 1.5 and 2, but just a starting point. And this is what we had at hand, but it already points to substantial differences. And I know there's been other papers, also recent reviews on risks for ocean systems that also point to similar results for many other ocean systems as well. And I strongly agree that interconnecting those and looking at compound risks, in particular in ocean systems, is very important.
Thank you. So I'm here to talk about what are the differences between 2 and 1.5 degrees for terrestrial biodiversity. So it's sort of the biodiversity side of Pete Smith's talk, where he's covered the BECCS and we're looking at how we can combine this together. So I want to recognize. So I want to recognize the research team, Professor Rachel Warren at Tundra Climate Change Center, and she has a poster who's looked at mitigation and global impacts on biodiversity, and so she works on the climate side. And Dr. Jeremy Vanderwall, who's the director of the Center for Tropical Biodiversity and Climate Change at James Cook University, and the co-director of eResearch, who leads one of the top teams on biodiversity modeling in the world. And I'll tell you right now, it's very handy to be friends with and have a colleague who has his own high-performance computing cluster. This study has been partially funded by the Helix EU project on the modeling side, and also by World Wildlife Fund UK, specifically looking at the impacts on their regions on biodiversity. The goal of the Wallace Initiative overall is to map refugia and species migratory pathways and species range shifts under varying amounts of climate change, as well as to look at the robustness of the current and future protected area systems. So far, we've modeled the potential climate change impacts on just under 80,000 terrestrial species, 60,000 plants, 9,000 birds, and the rest scattered among mammals, reptiles, and amphibians, across 21 climate models, 4 different dispersal scenarios at temperatures ranging from less than 2 to greater than 7 degrees C. And we've done all of this at a global spatial resolution of about 20 kilometers by 20 kilometers. We tried to go higher, we broke the cluster and generated about a petabyte of data, which we're still mining through. We identify refugia in terms of macro refugia, which is basically by climate exposure for the species and probability of species loss. And specifically, especially for this talk, anytime I use the term refugia, that simply means a region that remains climatically suitable for more than 75% of the species modeled in that area. For 1.5 to 2 degrees, that's the only thing that really matters. When you get up above 4 degrees, we talk about things like areas of concern, which where it becomes climatically unsuitable for greater than 75%, with a huge range in between. All ecoregions that we've looked at see some benefit with a global temperature rise constrained to 1.5 degrees versus 2 degrees. We use a difference in number of climate models that agree that an area models to be a refugia as an approximation for potential adaptation effort in the future. And the idea behind this is adaptation effort to maintain the status quo as opposed to adaptation effort to facilitate change to the next state. So the greater the number of climate models that are in agreement that an area is actually a refugia, the greater the likelihood that business as usual conservation and resiliency building will be successful as an adaptation strategy, which is something that environmental groups want to hear. They typically don't want to hear, you need to help facilitate and help this area change from one ecosystem type to another. They don't know how to do that. So what I'll do now is for the various regions, just give a summary across plants and then summarize it across all taxa, because of course plants make up the habitat. What these maps all show is white generally indicates no change one way or the other. So they could currently be refugia or they could not be refugia, but the difference between 1.5 and 2 degrees, there isn't one that can be detected. And in this case, this purplish color isn't necessarily bad, it simply means really no change. So as the colors shade from purple up to around the beginning of the green colors, you're beginning to see areas where there are major differences in designation of an area as potentially as a refugia between 1.5 and 2 degrees. These are the areas where that half degree really makes a difference. And the greener it is, the greater the difference overall. And so what the difference is if you're talking about these areas that are bright green, some of the areas around Spain and Portugal, for example, or up through France, these are all areas that would not be considered a refugia at 2 degrees at all. So the impact would already be great enough, even at 2 degrees, that you would be seeing the climate become unsuitable for more than 25% of the species model. But by holding it to 1.5 degrees, you're seeing that these areas essentially are benefited. And what I can say is that particularly for this area in Spain, the reason it's purple is because even at 1.5 degrees, the impacts, the modeled impacts are fairly high. The numbers at the bottom are simply the World Wildlife Fund priority regions, and the percentage of that region which sees an increase of 10 or more models that are being refugia. So basically, from the point of view of advising adaptation efforts for an environmental group is saying that, in this case in the Mediterranean, 31% of the area would be more amenable to adaptation using current practices than it would under 2 degrees. And by 2 degrees, you're having to look at new ways to adapt. For North America, the same sort of pattern repeats. Parts of what would normally be drier areas, short grass prairies into the montane, southeast is also subject to many droughts, and then parts of what used to be tall grass prairie always see benefits by being 1.5 degrees versus 2 degrees, whereas much of what is typically considered as classic eastern deciduous forest, it doesn't really matter. 1.5 and 2 degrees are approximately the same. Also the same is true up through the rainforest regions of British Columbia and Alaska. For South America, what you see is huge areas where it doesn't matter. And in this case, in many of them, it's because you've already crossed that threshold where it's no longer a refugia. It simply means it's become climatically unsuitable for more than 25% of the species, but not up to 75%. So it's in that zone where adaptation will be much harder. This area through here, where it's mostly purple, is simply because even at 2, 3, and 4 degrees, it is a refugia. It's some of the real hot spots for conservation. And then looking at Pete Smith's map or the overlap where agriculture is, that's the best place to save biodiversity, and it's one of the biggest conflict zones in the future. And the areas without agriculture, there isn't much going on even with the biodiversity. So again, what you're seeing though is in the remaining Brazilian Atlantic rainforest, parts of the sub-Amazonian basin, you're beginning to see areas where that difference between 1.5 to 2 degrees is high. Africa, same story, large areas where there's no difference. In this case, there aren't many plants, but in this case, it's severely, it becomes climatically unsuitable for large percentages of plants, even at 1.5 degrees. So that half a degree, while it makes a difference, it doesn't make a quantitative difference in terms of an area being a refugee or not, but it does make a very big difference when you get down into the Namib, Karoo, and Finbos, and then parts over in here into coastal East Africa, and not the rainforests of Madagascar, which tend to be fine, but the more semi-arid regions of Madagascar, that extra half a degree makes a large difference. Finally, Asia, again, back to the talk on BECCS and biodiversity. This area right here in green is one of the key areas that came up in some of the maps. So this is an area where you would advise on conservation biodiversity. This would be a really good area for protected areas. It's important for biodiversity. That half a degree makes a big difference. And yet you're going to have competition for land uses, high competition for land uses, as well as in South India and much of Southeast Asia. And finally, looking at Australasia, less in Australia, although mostly along the coastal zones, do you see benefits along the edges of the deserts, but especially in through Indonesia, South Borneo, and New Guinea, that half a degree again makes a very large difference from a terrestrial point of view. And in some cases, for example, the coral triangle, the difference between 2 and 1.5 degrees is 42%. So a large percentage of the land mass benefits at 2 versus 1.5 degrees. But what difference does it make? It depends on the pathway, and it's something we really need to talk a lot about because all of us do approximately the same thing for looking at 1.5 degrees. We look at a point in time when the climate models hit 1.5. For biodiversity, that's generally okay. If you have a more stochastic system, you actually want a little higher resolution temporally. So if the climate slowly warms to reach 1.5, and Richard Betts talks about this, some taxa should be able to largely keep up. This would be especially the birds and mammals. If the climate reaches 1.5 quickly and then holds, many taxa may be able to catch up. But if there's an overshoot, which Corinne talked about, basically the impacts will largely be those of the overshoot temperature for everything except perhaps plants, and recovery would take much longer. And then the question of the frog is, well, what if I get to 4 degrees, do I want to go back? Well, if you've evolved, going back means evolving again, because you've selected those taxa out that are good for high temperatures, and if it's now low temperatures, they're impacted. So you have a double bottleneck they have to go through. So we know from looking at phenological studies, looking at current distributions, that many mammals, birds, reptiles, amphibians, track climate year to year very well, either through failed breeding or through movements. Plants, you see it in terms of failed reproduction, failed seed set, greater insect disturbance, and greater fire. Can they keep up? There are large disagreements in the literature over rates of change. It depends on how you look at the paleoecological literature and how you look at the phenological literature. The dispersal rates we're talking about here are the ones that we used in a paper on Nature Climate Change. But none of the estimates take into account the availability of movement pathways or gradients or barriers. Corridors may not work. We assume, as working on adaptation, that corridors will work. Species don't have maps. They don't know that you can get from point A to point B by following this pathway. So they may not work at all. They often don't exist, although here's a case where mitigation could help. And ultimately, bioenergy could lead to more barriers, in which case 1.5 degrees for biodiversity in some parts of the world may actually be worse than 2 degrees. So it's a question of where are the biofuels, where is bioenergy going to be? So here's an example. Can a species keep up? This is the area around Norwich, and what you see is an incredibly fragmented landscape. And so if species has to get from here to here, there's no clear path. And even birds that fly, just because a bird flies, most individuals stay within about 1 kilometer of where they were born. Those few individuals contribute to population diversity, but not much to movement. But it's not just the temperate areas. This is the central Amazon around the city of Manaus. You can already see, obviously, Manaus is very large. This is a long-term ecological research site. And you're seeing a large amount of fragmentation, mostly from agriculture. If you zoom in, this is a 2016 image, so you're seeing a large amounts of fragmentation already in the landscape. And if we have to have higher levels of agriculture for food security or energy, ultimately that could come at the risk of biodiversity. Many of the areas with large benefits, though, are not necessarily those with the greatest impact at higher temperatures. So many areas of benefit at low temperatures don't see as much benefit at higher temperatures. So it's sort of a temperature is a one-off thing tied to tipping points. And overall, plants seem to benefit the most and reptiles the least by holding the temperature rise to 1.5 rather than 2 degrees. Regionally, coastal East Africa benefits the most, averaging a 22% reduction in adaptation effort. And the African Rift Lakes and the Orinoco of South America closely follow, and then Madagascar and the Namib Karoo. So these would be the sort of the winners in terms of terrestrial biodiversity. But it's important to realize that we model means, for the most part impact modelers do. Extremes will likely mean that impacts occur sooner than modeled and are perhaps a greater impact overall. Land use is and will continue to be a problem and barrier to biodiversity. There are large uncertainties in the timing of any of this, so the lags of when a plant or even an animal might be impacted and how quickly they can disperse. And therefore, mitigation has the potential to either help or hinder biodiversity adaptation. Thank you.
One of the challenges we have in the tropics is having a clear idea of what the upper thermal limit is. So for a temperate species, you can see the bottom end of its range and say that's a thermal limit. That upper thermal limit isn't possibly actually experienced. The temperature is what it is now. So how do you deal with assuming what the thermal limit is?
Well, largely the same way you do with temperate organisms. But the other thing to keep in mind for tropical areas is that they've actually been exposed, generally speaking, over the last near term, so we're not like paleoecology now, to a much smaller temperature range overall. I suspect for many of these species, not necessarily the plants, they may actually be tied to their food resource. And without actually directly knowing exactly each individual food resource and having a model, and we're just beginning to model the invertebrates. Getting a really good handle on the tropics, especially the South American tropics, is a little trickier. We do know the same modeling techniques have been used for fire, and have done a very good job of modeling fire. So in terms of things like fire risk in plants, it's all part of the indirect part that go into these types of models overall. But I think really hard about the tropics all of the time, about how whether or not our adaptation strategies are worthwhile.
Any more very fast questions? It's one fast one.
Yes, thanks, Jeff. I guess a word of caution on the on your slide. You had the, you know, some cases 2 degrees is better than 1.5 degrees.
No, the 1.5 would be worse than 2.
That taken out of context, you know, if you consider the other impacts that we've had this morning in the oceans and the like, it's a risk.
Great, thank you. Thank you. Our next speaker is Karim Bergaoui. Hi, good afternoon. So I will present today our work in the International Center for Biosaline Agriculture in Dubai on assessing the impact of 1.5 and 2 degrees warming scenarios on durum wheat production in Tunisia. And please let me introduce quickly our center. So it's based in the middle of the desert in Dubai, and we are focused on providing adaptation solutions for adaptation of crop systems under marginal environments using marginal water, saline water, or treated wastewater. And our team here is from the Department of Climate Change and Modeling and Adaptation, and our focus is to produce high resolution scenarios of climate change models for the Middle East and North African region, where there is little research in the region. And in fact, in this region, the climate change is a reality. And our recent work last year with Dan Mitchell team on the extreme drought event in the Levant region in Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, was showing that clearly that anthropogenic climate change is the cause of the extreme drought we are seeing there. And so, in fact, we are in a region where there is it's a scarce water, and it comes to the problem of refugees. So 40% of the refugees in the world are in the Middle East and North African region, and they come to add the stress to the water resources and to the food security. For example, in Tunisia, 2 million Libyan are there since 5 years, and they are causing a lot of stress on water and food security in the country. So that's why we choose Tunisia to study the impact of the 1.5 and 2 degrees scenarios and see the impact on the crop yield. We used for this study the DSAT, the Decision Support System for Agrotechnological Transfer Model. It's a 1D model developed by Georgia University. We try to improve it with Wisconsin University to run it at a gridded version for the country. And it's composed of five main components: the weather, which is driven by with the era anterim or happy models; the management, where we describe the tillage, the planting date, organic fertilization, organic matter application, irrigation. The soil component is done by the sensory module, where we model the soil dynamics and soil water, soil plant atmosphere, transfer of energy between the soil, the plant, and the atmosphere with the evapotranspiration mainly. And the plant model is a crop grow model we use here, and we tune the genetic coefficients to better represent the crop cultivar used for this study for wheat, durum wheat in Tunisia. And because the soil moisture is a very important parameter, the residual soil water is important to inform on the start of season, of growing season. So we use the land information system we ran it to initialize the soil moisture in the model. We use the same physiographic data, FAO soil texture, and a modified land use. And we use the data simulation with satellite data, GRACE, MODI, SASCAL, to correct the trajectory of the model and inform on the soil moisture in the rooting zone, which is very important. In a country like Tunisia, there is a big interannual variability, so the soil moisture can vary too much between a dry year and a wet year. Then we divided the country into 10 homogeneous agroecological zones, where we have the same agricultural practices. And here is the Atlas Mountains, and most of the crop production of cereals is 85% is in the northern of the mountain Atlas, and 15% is in the south. Then we tuned the genetic coefficients of the model to represent the widely used cultivar of durum wheat there, using our large series of data we have in Tunisia, and we were able to reproduce 85% correlation with the observed crop production. So the model was ready, and we ran it for 10 years using weather at home data, 1.5 degrees, and we were able to reproduce around 70% the observed crop yield of wheat. For the northern part of the country. For the southern part, the correlation was low, 30%, but the values of the crop yield was very close to the observations. Then we used the HUD AM3 data. So we took the median scenario for the maximum temperature. It was representing the climatology of temperature, but for the rainfall it was slightly dry biased. In fact, here are the observations from the stations and from TRIM data, and the black curve is the median scenario of monthly precipitation, and we saw that the model was dry biased, and it confirmed what we found during our study in the Levant region. The model is highly dry biased, and we were obliged to apply CDF matching technique to unbias the model. The change in precipitation is around -20% for this 1.5 scenario. We didn't use the 2 degrees yet because the data are not yet ready. But and then the response of the DSAT model is showing an interesting signal. So it was positive for the northern part and negative for the southern part of the Atlas Mountains. So the model is ready now to be coupled with all the HAPI data. It's reproducing the observed crop yield for the North African region. The 1.5 degree scenario is showing an increase for the northern part of the country, an increase in crop production. We will look at all the HAPI models, and we will try to choose the best reproducing the climatology and run the two scenarios and see the impact on the crop production. Thank you.
We have a question for three. Rachel?
Yeah, thanks. It's really cool that you've already managed at least part of the simulations. I'm just wondering quite a specific question about using the HAPI data, so we'll have these large ensembles of 1.5 and 2 degrees. And I was just thinking about your impact on how many runs do you think that you'd actually be able to do with your model, bearing in mind that there are going to be quite a lot that are used.
But we will try to use all the members, so we will run it with 100 members, yes. It's possible, it's parallelized, and we can do it.
Great, thanks.
Any more questions?
Along those lines, they're checking humidity numbers for the soil moisture.
So
we have the soil depth moisture we need.
Yes.
We talked about earlier.
Yes.
So we're good.
The soil might
be. Yeah, they've got the data you need. So
excellent. This is very important. This is very important. Thank you.
Miles. There's some different ideas on how to bias the grains. This might be an opportunity, and then, people in the audience who know more about this than I do, but might be an opportunity to look at the impact of how you do the bias correction on the actual impact assessment.
For this study, we didn't.
It's not a question, it's more just a kind
of usually we use the CDF matching, but and it worked well for the recent study on the Levant region.
We're going to bias correct the data in two different ways.
Yeah,
that'll be available to you anyway, so you can.
We have to.
Maybe we could use the easy bias correction method as well and see how it compares.
Yes.
Do we have any other questions? I've just got one question to ask. So in Carl's talk, Carl spoke about the Mediterranean being one of the regions where we do see a large difference between 1.5 and 2 degrees. But what you were showing in there is some really quite large biases. But do you have any thoughts on what we can do to improve those biases, especially considering it looks like it's one of these hotspot regions?
So what to do in the regional models? So from our experience in North African region, the soil moisture is very important. The soil moisture and the sea surface temperature, of course. And this underestimation comes mainly from the convection, the misrepresentative process of the convection in that region, mainly.
Right. Okay. Great. Excellent. Thanks very much, Karim. So our next speaker is Bowyer.
Okay, so good afternoon, everybody. Forward or backwards? Backwards. So I'm going to talk to you today about the differential climate impacts in Europe at 1.5, 2 and 3 degrees. This is work that was done in the Impact 2C project, where we looked at changes not just in Europe, but also in Africa and Asia. But what I present today, can I have the laptop, please? And I'm going to present results for Europe. So an issue that came up this morning was how to define the warming periods. So the approach that we took in Impact 2C was to define our pre-industrial period as the period there, 1881 to 1910, and we did that on the basis that this was a time period common to the three observational data sets that we analysed. And we calculated the difference between the pre-industrial and our base period for our analysis in Impact 2C, 1971 to 2000. And then we calculated a running mean, a 30-year running mean for the GCMs to calculate the additional level of warming, which would then exceed our respective temperature threshold, if that's 1.5 or 2. If we do that, we can produce a table like this. So this is a list of the RCM-GCM pairs that we used in Impact 2C, and this summarizes the time period at which the respective RCM-GCMs crosses the respective temperature threshold. So that was the basis for the climate databases that we had to look at impacts in Europe in different economic sectors. So let's start by looking at one index, the climate index, cold day duration index, and this is for an area in southern Finland. And what these plots show you, so the top left is the historical period, they're all 30-year time series plots of the historical period and the three temperature thresholds. And the blue lines represent the RCP 2.6 simulations, orange lines are RCP 4.5, and the red lines are RCP 8.5. So what we see there already in a 1.5 degrees world is that the dashed line there on the historical period and on all the plots is the 95th percentile of historical. And what we see in a 1.5 degrees C world is that almost the worst cold snaps almost disappear in a 1.5 degree world in southern Finland. That's a pattern that's repeated at 2 degrees as well, and at 3 degrees we're seeing even fewer occurrences of these cold snaps. So if we look at changes in growing season length, this time for an area in Brandenburg in Germany, same setup as the previous plots, and what we see here for a 1.5 degree world is that we're getting an increase in the length of the growing season, and that's a pattern that's seen at 2 degrees and 3 degrees as well. If we actually calculate the increase in the length of the growing season for 1.5 and 2 degrees, it's more or less a month. So the length of the growing season increasing by about a month at 1.5 and 2. And for 3, it's similar also. So not a big difference between 1.5 and 2 for that particular case. And if we look at heatwave duration index, again, same setup with the plots, we're seeing an increase in the number of heatwave years or extreme extended heatwave years. So the dashed line again is the 95th percentile of historical. What we see in 1.5 degree world is that we're getting many more years which exceed the 95th percentile of the present day. And if you actually calculate some increases in the changes in the occurrence of those events for a 1.5 and 2 degree world, so the years where you get more extreme heatwave events increases by about 3 or 4 times more frequently in a 1.5 and 2 degree world. And if you look at the 3 degree world, those the frequency increases about 12 times. So that's some climate indices. What if we go and look at some impacts in the tourism sector? So the question here was looking at tourism, winter tourism demand. So the question was, in a warmer world, how might snow conditions change? And as snow conditions change, how sensitively do people react to how they decide to go for skiing holidays and where they might decide to go for skiing holidays? And we use the concept of the weather value at risk to look at this, which is represents the maximum expected loss resulting from adverse weather conditions at a given confidence level. And adverse weather conditions in the context of skiing might be not enough precipitation and warm temperatures. What we did was develop a regression model based on the hydrological model VIC simulations of snow water equivalents. So we established a relationship between the change in the number of overnight stays, which is our measure of the value at risk, and changes in the snow index. And the snow index was the fraction of days where the snow water equivalent was greater than or equal to 120 millimetres. So we drove the VIC hydrological model with EOBS data to get our calibration, and then we apply that relationship to VIC simulations of RCP 8.5. And in constructing that statistical relationship between changes in overnight stays and snow index, there were also socioeconomic factors that went in there, such as GDP per capita and population. And so if we look at the results of that, this is a plot of changes in the number of overnight stays for RCP 8.5. Simulations at 1.5, 2 and 3 degrees for the countries in Europe that have a significant skiing industry. And we see at 1.5, we're seeing some change, some large change. So there's about a million and a half overnight stays in Austria, the first column on the left, are at risk in a 1.5 degree world. And as we go to 2, there's an increase, but it's not a big increase. As we go to 3 degrees for Austria, we get a more appreciable increase in the difference between 1.5 and 3. And for the other countries, Italy comes off pretty badly as well. For the other countries in Europe, it's not so bad. So a similar approach now in the energy sector. We looked at changes, or could we establish a relationship between temperature increase and electricity load. So lots of different factors that go to making up or explain variation in electricity load, and we try to remove the various factors such as summer tourism. So if everybody goes on holiday to Spain or France and Italy, you might want to remove that from your data so you get a cleaner hit at the relationship between temperature and electricity load. And we did that again using historical data between electricity load and daily mean temperature, and it applied that to the climate simulations for 5 to 3 degrees. So this plot shows you the relative change in mean annual electricity demand for all of the countries in the European Union. And what we see in a 1.5 degree world, 2 degree world, 3 degree world, is that most countries, well, all countries in the EU, apart from Italy, have a reduction in electricity demand. The differences between 1.5 and 2 degrees are not that great, if you can make that out. But between 1.5 and 3, those differences become more pronounced. And for normal, you can see in a 1.5 degree world, you get a reduction in electricity demand of around about 3 and 4%. So if we look at the water sector, so this is some work that Chantal Donnelly and colleagues are in the process of writing a paper on. So they looked at a bunch of different changes in water, but this slide shows you changes in mean annual total runoff. And the setup here was the 5 hydrological models, which are listed there. And what these plots show you is the changes for mean annual total runoff at those different temperature thresholds. And the stippling on the plots shows you areas where the multimodal mean, or the change in the multimodal mean, is larger than the standard deviation from the multimodal mean. And we see at 1.5 degrees, there's N2 and N3, there's similar patterns. So northern and eastern parts of Europe are getting wetter, and more southerly parts are getting drier. And that relationship becomes more pronounced as we progress through and as the planet warms. So finally, to get some changes in ecosystems, so changes in net primary production. Two models used here, CLM and LPJML. And what we see for 1.5 and 2 degrees here, we didn't have simulations for 3 degrees, is that on the whole, across Europe, vegetation becomes more productive. And that's more pronounced at 2 degrees, so if we calculate the difference between 2 and 1.5, we get this. And so across most parts of Europe, we're getting an increased productivity in a two degree world compared to a 1.5. It's just some parts of southern Spain, parts of Norway, where that might not be the case. So that's a fairly rapid run through of some of the results that we and the analysis that we've done in Impact to see. And so just to try and summarise, based on the evidence that I've presented here, there are some appreciable impacts that we can see in a 1.5 degree world. But overall, the differential between 1.5 and 2 in the analysis considered here is not that considerable. It becomes more pronounced once we go to 3 degrees C. So I've given you a rapid run through of some of the work. If you want to find out more, there's a web address there, and we also produced an online atlas which shows some of these results if you want to go look at it. And I didn't do all this work, so I'm grateful to colleagues who've provided input to these slides. Too many to mention there, but their names are listed. And I thank you for listening. Thank you. So in the beginning, the focus was looking at 2 degrees and 1.5. As the project first started, I think the attitude was, oh, you know, 1.5 isn't really that interesting. So probably about a year after the project started, we were asked to look at 3 degrees. And then latterly, with Paris and what have you, we did look at 1.5. So from the start, 1.5 was always there. But the focus did shift to 3.2, with the difference between 2 and 3 as the project progressed, and then the focus did shift towards the end. Yeah.
This one behind and then come off.
I'm working with the Italian government, and they are reflecting upon different scenarios. Which arguments would you highlight to a policymaker based on your model to say, listen, it's better that Italy tries to be 1.5 and not 2. That is, we are working on mitigation but also on conservation. So which are the three messages that you would have for a specific government? I'm saying Italy because I'm interested in Italy. I'm a voice there, but probably others in other countries. So which derives from the research?
So the question is, why would I recommend 1.5 compared to 2?
Which are good arguments?
Yeah. Okay. So, I mean, based on the work here, I've shown you that there isn't much difference. But the arguments for 1.5, as we've heard today, are mostly, but considerably from small island states and sea level rise. Where the difference between 1.5.
No desertification for the south of Italy, let's say.
Sorry?
No desertification for the south of Italy. There is a double spell of rise.
Well, I mean, the general point is we want to achieve 1.5 if we can. And to do that, based on what I've shown you, the differences aren't that great, but there's a bigger issue. The issue of desertification in Italy, I couldn't say, but generally, if we don't want to go above 1.5, it's much better if we don't. So.
I don't think it's really on the car, like, thanks.
Just two short questions. One on the NPT production. Do you know if these models by any chance are able to capture effects of extreme events in NPT? And secondly, generally for, let's say, scaling of these changes, to what extent do you indicate a scale linear, neo non-linear?
Okay. Do the vegetation models deal with extremes? That's a question I really can't tell you because I can't answer this. I didn't do that work. In terms of non-linearity, I can't answer that. It's not very satisfactory.
Thanks very much. So our next speaker is Bruce.
Great, thanks. And we're talking about a different part of the world now than the other guests would like to have them. Laptop, and there's also a lot of collaborators not listed here. I'm just presenting, but there's partners. We have an Academy of Finland project ended 3 weeks ago, the title of which was Resilience in Social Ecological Systems of Northwest Eurasia, funded by the Academy of Finland. And then we have an ongoing JPI climate project. We're about a year and a half into that's going to run for another 2.5 years. So partners in the Nordic countries, Scotland, and of course, Russia. So go next. And this is the part of the world that we're talking about. The map, what you see in white are reindeer herding areas of Northwest Eurasia. So these are In the case of the Nordic countries, privately owned animals that are herded. In Russia, it's now a mixture of state or collective owned and privately owned. And this Yamal Peninsula here, how many heard of this summer because of the anthrax outbreak and or the methane emissions and or the fires? Yeah, is in the news these three times, and I'm going to be focusing particularly on this area. But to give you an idea, the reindeer herders you saw on the last slide, they migrate about 1,200 kilometers annually between winter pastures south of the Old Bay up to the Kara Sea, where the calves feed on the coast. So NASA air temperature trends for about a 40-year period up to 2014. Here's annual and degrees Celsius at the bottom. Spring on the top right, winter bottom right, fall here, summer here. So we've already exceeded 1.5. We're already actually getting close to over 2 degrees Celsius warming. And you can see these, look at the winter warming here. This is what I'm going to be talking about today, but the summer warming is what you're hearing about. The record summer we just had led to these methane bubbles developing up on Ostrov Belly here. Actually, for those who aren't familiar with this region, I put circles in to show. So this area running from Fennoscandia over to Tenere Peninsula is the target zone. But indigenous peoples, Sami in the Nordic countries, and Nenets are going to be talking about today, they've been observing all these changes. So we take a lot of cues for what direction our work goes by what's affecting them. One of the things we noticed several years ago was that herders said since the 1970s, willows and other shrubs in the tundra had grown now up over the tops of the antlers of their animals. These were shrubs that were down around their knees when these guys who are my age, mid-50s, in the 70s, they were teenagers. So we've been doing dendroclimatology work with that. We've reconstructed summer temperatures, and we find, yes, they are growing more quickly. That's both east and west of the Urals, and that's both willows and alder. And the systems we find are teleconnected. So what's happened in West Siberia is an increasing frequency and intensity of high-pressure systems that are teleconnected to Fennoscandia. So we have cool, rainy weather over Fennoscandia. We have big high pressures like we had this summer over West Siberia. And that's reflected in the shrub data. So reindeer are really at the center of the provisional ecosystem services. Year-round, they're providing food, clothing, shelter, and even companionship. What people don't write about is in summer, people aren't slaughtering reindeer because the skins are molting. They're living mainly on fish. And that's one of the first things we noticed to be affected when the oil and gas moved into the area. So this is a major gas production area. Gas is going in the Nord Stream pipeline, coming down to Primorsk and going west from there. So herders have already adapted to a lot of change. You see a lot of infrastructure there. They basically move right through the middle of the largest gas field at Bowyer. That said, they've adapted quite well. They're doing, because of best practices by Gazprom, which we reviewed in the Arctic Human Development Report that came out 2 years ago. I led the chapter on resource governance, and it's doing as well as it can right now. The problem is if it goes to full production, but with gas prices and gas being fracked in other places, there's maybe less demand for that Arctic gas. But what I wanted to talk about today is the increasing frequency of rain on snow events. The winters have been warming too. It's not just hot summers, it's warmer winters. It's later freeze up in fall, earlier melt out in spring. So the winter of 2013-14, 61,000 animals out of about 300,000, actually about 275,000 died on the Yamal Peninsula. That's about 22% of the whole population. So the free use of space, herders, has been a concern as the oil and gas has developed, particularly in the 1980s, but now it's ramping up fairly quickly. And the herders we work with said there's about one major rain on snow event per decade, but they're getting more intense. So we reviewed the 2006 and 7 events. There's actually two ice crust layers the herds couldn't get through, and then the massive one in 2013-14. So herders are starting to get into a situation where they're worried their collective agency that has worked well for the oil and gas adaptation is not going to be enough when 27,000 square kilometers of pastures are locked under ice. So when it started, the rain occurred in November, but then it went back down to minus 40, so the ice persisted through the winter. And in March, they said 15,000 reindeer had died, but that was, it was like a train wreck in slow motion. It kept going on and on. So by May, they said more than 60,000 animals, and they weren't going to be able to do a count until the slaughter takes place at EU standard slaughterhouses down near the Ob River. Gemal is like an elbow, and down at the bottom at the elbow, there is a EU slaughterhouse where they did the final count. So this is that elbow area there, and this is data from the ASCAP satellite. So that doesn't look like much, but it is about 27,000 square kilometers locked in the ice. The data you see other here, these are from AIRS, Atmospheric Infrared Sounder, and they show the 2006 event here. You can see the warm, this is precipitable water here coming up and going over this area of Yamal on November 7th, and the Met records reflect this, and the herders very accurately through radio contact with each other said where the soft snow was and where to get your animals to quickly, and they lost, some of the herds lost 25%. All the herds over the whole area lost 25% in the 2013 event, where you see the precipitable water here on November 8th, 9th moving past the region, and 10th away. But here's the temperature in 2013. You can see this really warm patch here, November 8th. It's gone by the 9th, and then by the 10th, it's back down to minus 40.
So what's the problem with rain on snow?
It causes a hard crust that you and I, if it's just a crust on the surface, you'd have trouble breaking through it with a shovel. It's so thick, because it rained for 24 hours on a deep snow layer.
Why is that a problem?
The reindeer can't get to the lichens underneath. That's the reindeer here. The lichens are down here. So people were actually out with pickaxes and shovels, and anything, any piece of lumber in camp was used to try to break through these two layers in 2006. What happened in 2013 is it actually saturated the whole snow layer. So it was just the snow just became a massive ice block covering 27,000 square kilometers. So these are the mildest pictures I can show you here. Those are not sleeping reindeer. Those are dead, frozen in. They were frozen in piles and they were burned in place. And that was before the anthrax. So the worry now, they're actually talking about culling 250,000 animals. Now the discussion is. So I'll summarize. The warming temperatures throughout the region, they've been reflected in the growth of tall deciduous shrubs. Herders have noticed this. It affects their migration patterns, where they go. They don't want to lose animals. There's a strong grazing, heavy grazing or overgrazing narrative that's been sustained over several decades, but the satellite data and our ground level data tell us these shrubs are actually becoming more productive. So the overgrazing argument seems to be about the lichen coverage. The lichens are actually doing well south of the Ob. So there's been a lot of focus on warmer summers, but the greening of the Arctic tells us it's related to sea ice retreat. We're finding it's not. But the rain on snow events, we do seem to find a sea ice trigger. So these data are now in review with biology letters, actually the second round of review, so we're hoping this will be out soon. So the temperatures already exceeded 1.5 envisioned by the COP21 Paris Agreement. And what's actually driving the rain on snow is not clear. So this one we've been using SIMS data, partnering with the National Snow and Ice Data Center and NASA to get the sea ice data. And there actually is a very synchronized period, just a few days in both November. You saw those November dates in 2006 and almost the same November dates in 2013, when sea ice should have been linearly increasing in the Barents and Kara Sea. It started to dip down, and that's when the rain occurred over the continent. So there's been a lot of recent modeling and simulations on that. It's so far mostly only speculation, but we're trying to get beyond that now. So I mentioned the big event, 61,000 out of 275,000 animals, and now they're talking about slaughtering 250 because of this anthrax. So the people are getting hit really hard now. There's going to be a meeting in Salekar the second week of November specifically about this. So if the sea ice continues to retreat, what herders are worried about, they've been talking about oil and gas and their abilities to adapt to that, Now they're in a situation where what used to be considered extreme weather is now starting to look like a pattern. At the same time that the oil and gas infrastructure is continuing to expand, which can affect people's ability to move quickly when they need to get 10,000 animals from here to there, and there's 100 kilometers of locked-in pastures, that's the issue. So I'll stop there, and if there's any questions, I'll try to answer them. Yeah?
Two questions.
Yeah?
When is leaf drop?
When is what?
Leaf drop. Leaf drop. Yeah.
You mean for the willows?
For the willows.
It's there. I was just in actually eastern Siberia, they're senescing late August, early September.
And the other question is, have there been any measurements underneath to see whether or not it's actually offsetting permafrost melting?
That's a big question. There's a lot of effort going into that, because we talk about warm permafrost in Yamal, which is a bit of an oxymoron, but it's actually the case that the permafrost amplitude is actually getting closer to zero. So we're getting into a danger zone there. But the worry has been there's so much oil and gas infrastructure on that permafrost, but the feedbacks you're talking about are very real. There's not so much methane and carbon stored here as there is further east. 2 weeks ago, I got back from the Kalima River Delta, where the Yetama soils are a ticking time bomb in terms of methane and carbon content. But
I was thinking the reverse, because there's some work out of Alaska that's coming, so as the willows start growing up, it cools the soil and it freezes.
Yeah.
And so you're actually going to have warm soils then early in November to help melt.
Yeah, and it depends on the soil type. Yamal is a lot of, it's Pleistocene sands underlain by marine clay, so those Alaska soils that Matt Sturm and others work with are a fair bit richer.
Great. Yeah.
Oh, Tom.
In terms of adaptation options, I mean, you mentioned communication to try to find soft snow. Are there any other, it seems like it's such a large area.
What we recommend in this manuscript that's in review in Biology Letters is that even a couple days warning, if people were watching for that sea ice reduction, and what we used was a combination of empirical and ERA reanalysis data, which actually, they dovetail really well. I didn't put the ERA figure in, but with a couple days warning, they're starting to experiment with mobile slaughterhouses. And you could actually get some of those into position quickly enough to humanely slaughter the animals and actually have meat that's usable, rather than people losing all their animals, their ability to move, and getting no gain on their only form of capital, which are the reindeer.
Great, thanks very much. So our next speaker is Emily Shuckburgh.
Emily, can you try and stand around here?
Yeah, and how do we?
We'll turn the mic around, we'll turn the laptop around.
Okay. Thank you. So I'm going to talk about the polar regions and changes in the polar regions, and then the impact of those changes on the rest of global climate. And I guess the key message that I'm wanting to give is that some of the pictures that we saw this morning, where there was shown to be a linear increase between global average surface temperature and then some impact, doesn't really apply in the polar regions for a variety of reasons, and then that has a knock-on effect on the rest of global climate. And a corollary of that is that a lot of the dynamical processes in the polar regions, often which are very poorly modeled in or parameterized in climate models, are quite subtle, and that has quite a big impact, and so globally. And so I'll try and highlight some of that, and then with the sort of unspoken implications for then looking at impact studies around the world. So, thank you. So just to give you a little bit of an overview as to why the polar regions might be particularly interesting in this respect and give rise to non-linear behaviour. In the southern hemisphere, in the Antarctic, over this coming century, we've got two competing things. There's the effect of increased greenhouse gases, but then there's also the effect of recovery of the ozone hole, which has a big impact on southern hemisphere climate, and I'll show you an example of that. In the northern hemisphere in particular, there are interesting feedbacks in terms of the sea ice and how we're just starting to understand how reductions in sea ice in the Arctic, particularly in different areas of the Arctic, then has a knock-on effect on the rest of northern hemisphere climate and can indeed act through feedback processes in an opposing way to the way in which increases in global surface temperature impacts the northern hemisphere climate. And the other way in which you can get interesting non-linear behaviour is through different timescales of responses of the dynamics in different parts of the system. So in particular, there's now increased understanding of the importance of the different fast timescales on which the surface ocean responds to change, particularly the ocean around Antarctica, the Southern Ocean, compared to the rather slower timescales at which the internal ocean responds, and how those two interact with each other. So one implication of that, for example, is that over the short term, a response to some of the atmospheric changes that we're seeing in the southern hemisphere may be an increase in the amount of sea ice that we have around Antarctica, as indeed we've seen over recent years. But then the longer term response would be one of a decrease in sea ice. And trying to understand and indeed model that is very challenging, not least because some of these key internal ocean dynamics are some of the things that are most difficult to parameterize in ocean climate models. Okay, so I can, we'll skip over that. So I'll talk about the Antarctic first of all, and some of the work that we've been doing there, just to give you a couple of examples of how this plays out. So this is what happens. This is my sort of schematic of the atmosphere ocean ice system in Antarctica. You have very strong winds that blow around Antarctica, and then there's an overturning circulation in the ocean, which is critically important both for bringing water underneath the ice sheets around Antarctica, and that's critical to the future stability of those ice sheets, as well as this ocean circulation connects up the whole global system. So if we look at the CMIP-5, the models that were in the last IPCC report, and how they are changing under different future scenarios, this is looking at the end of century surface wind patterns under RCP 2.6, 4.5, and 8.5, and this is the change in wind patterns that you're seeing. And so under RCP 8.5, you see a significant strengthening in the wind shown in red there, whereas under RCP 2.6, you actually see the opposite sign of change. You actually see somewhat of a weakening of the wind. So this is an example where you can, between the two different scenarios, you can actually get an opposite sign of change. And that's a consequence of having this competing effect of the recovery of the ozone over this time period, as well as greenhouse gas forcing. Those winds are critically important for driving the ocean circulation, and so then it's important to try and understand what the knock-on effect of that is on the ocean circulation. There are other competing effects on the ocean circulation as well, not least what happens to the sea ice, because the sea ice provides important forcings in terms of the input of fresh water and salinity into the ocean around Antarctica. What we see, again, between the difference, those three different scenarios, RCP 2.6, 4.5 and 8.5, is significant differences in different parts, different depths of the Southern Ocean in terms of, for example, the temperature properties. So that if we look at the surface waters, then under RCP 2.6, we see over the course of the century a levelling off of the change in temperature. So these two top plots here represent surface waters. But as we move below the surface, then even under RCP 2.6, throughout the century, we continue to see increase in temperatures of those waters. And that's important because it's these deeper waters, the waters that actually come up underneath the ice sheets and can potentially make those ice sheets unstable. And indeed, there's some observational studies that are starting to indicate that key parts of the Antarctic ice sheet may already be in an irreversible retreat as a consequence of this warmer water coming up underneath. What if we move to the, if we look at what's been happening to the sea ice around Antarctica compared to the models, there is a huge range between the models in terms of their representation of Antarctic sea ice, and it's something that there's very significant uncertainty about. And indeed, if we look at these future model simulations, this is looking at the present day out 2 centuries into the future. Overall, the models show that under RCP 2.6, you get a plateauing of the change in Antarctic sea ice, but there's huge variation between the models, and that's a lot of what's driving variation in the rest of the regions in the Southern Hemisphere. It matters a lot how you model the Antarctic sea ice. Just switching up to the Arctic and just giving you a few insights as to why, through different processes, but there's similarly both the opportunity for the opposite sign of behaviour between different scenarios in the Arctic, but also the importance of getting some of the key, particularly sea ice processes, correct in the Arctic. So if we just move to the next. Thank you. So one of the key things here is that on the one hand, we have a similar process whereby through the sort of basic greenhouse effect, one would expect an impact on the winds the strength of the atmospheric jet in the northern hemisphere, just as we just saw in the southern hemisphere. But there's an additional effect that if you significantly reduce the sea ice in the Arctic, then that itself can have an impact on that atmospheric jet stream and might do so in the opposite direction to which the forcing from greenhouse gases has an impact. And indeed, in Europe and North America over recent years, there have been a number of occasions recently when we've seen exceptionally cold winter weather that's been attributed in some studies to this effect. So what we typically see, this is all associated with the main mode of variability in the Northern Hemisphere, the North Atlantic Oscillation. And so there's been a suggestion that through greenhouse gas forcing, we might more typically move more into a more positive mode of the North Atlantic Oscillation, which would be associated typically with warmer temperatures here in the UK, for example. But through Arctic sea ice loss, then that might drive us in the opposite direction. And then it becomes interesting looking at these different scenarios, because obviously, as you move through the century, then even under the lower atmospheric greenhouse gas forcing scenarios, you're still getting quite a significant decrease in Arctic sea ice. So that introduces the opportunity for having different effects between the different scenarios. And as we saw it in the Antarctic, sea ice is not well modelled in the Arctic either. This is 2 extreme examples of CMIP-5 models in terms of their sea ice. You probably can't see at the back there, but this is for 2050, and in this model, the September sea ice extent covers still much of the Arctic Ocean, whereas in this model it's restricted to a very, very, very small area. What our studies are showing is it's not just the total amount of sea ice that's critically important for determining the response throughout the Northern Hemisphere, but it's also exactly where that sea ice is lost from. And so we've been starting to try and understand this purely from a dynamical perspective, and we've done a number of idealized studies to try to determine exactly those subtleties of the dynamics linked together. And so should we show you the slide? This is again looking at the CMIP-5 models, and this is looking at the end of the century, again under these 3 different scenarios, RCP 2.6, 4.5, and 8.5. And this is just looking at the correlation between European temperatures here in different months and the amount of sea ice in the Barents Kara Sea. And the key message here, the details don't matter, but the key message here is once again, we're seeing the opportunity for having the opposite sign of behaviour between these different scenarios. So under this lower scenario, we're in a situation where you typically see, where you see less sea ice in the Barents Kara Sea, you see warmer European temperatures, but under the higher forcing scenarios, you see exactly the opposite. And when we've done idealized studies, where we have, just in an idealized way, either removed the sea ice in the Barents Kara Sea up here, or alternatively, in other parts of the Arctic Ocean, more in the Pacific sector, then we get entirely different temperature responses throughout the whole of the Northern Hemisphere. And so if you look at this end plot here, this is showing the different temperature patterns that you get through removing sea ice in those different regions. And if you look at Europe, for example, you see completely the opposite sign of the change according to whether or not you have the sea ice loss in one part of the Arctic Ocean versus another part of the Arctic Ocean. And the models show completely different things, each of them, in terms of where you expect to see that sea ice. So if you just take that one last plot and then think through in terms of impact, so if you're wanting to look at the impact of winter tourism in Europe, for example, I mean, you get completely different answers between these two different models. So it really matters the details of how these polar processes are represented. And that's showing the surface plots. This is showing what's happening, the change in the vertical. And again, you can see that as you move up, there's complete opposite sign in terms of the response in the stratosphere between sea ice loss in these different regions. And that points to what some of the key processes are in terms of generating these differences. And it's those key processes that we're now trying to understand how better to represent those in models. So, just in conclusion, the key points that I wanted to bring out, first of all, that in the polar regions there are opportunities for the dynamics leading to a different sign and response between, if you like, a 1.5, 2 degree RCP 2.6 kind of world and an RCP 8.5 world. Two of the mechanisms for that are in the Southern Hemisphere are the interaction with ozone recovery, and in the Northern Hemisphere, the impact of sea ice loss in the Arctic. It also showed that in the Southern Hemisphere we see continued significant change throughout the 21st and indeed 22nd century, even in these low impact scenarios. The circumpolar deep water, the water that then can get underneath the ice sheets, continues to warm, and actually the very bottom water, the Antarctic bottom water, also continues to warm. And one of the implications of this whole analysis is that getting the sea ice model right not just affects the polar regions but also has significant global impacts as well, and so it's critical that it's a critical area to improve in terms of models.
Thank you. Do you have any questions? Okay, we'll take all three, but very fast if we can.
Yeah. So, are you saying that this Barents Kara sea ice loss would see a dampening of the North Atlantic Oscillation's impact and Arctic Oscillation? And what's your feeling about this sign changing, the two radical scenarios? Which direction do you feel is more realistic based on the soil?
Yeah, so I'm not sure that we're yet at a stage where we want to necessarily make a strong statement about exactly what the impact of reducing sea ice in the Barents Kara Sea is, except that it clearly does have an impact. What I was showing was some very idealized models where we just literally took the whole of the Barents Kara Sea ice out just to give it a strong forcing. But it certainly seems to have a critical impact, and essentially because it sets off a dynamical chain of change that can actually also, as you saw, impact up into the stratosphere, which then itself has a knock-on effect. And The other question you asked was?
Well, just, yeah, as a North Atlantic oscillation, those bad years we've seen were NAO positive.
Yeah.
And the NAO just switched, so
yeah.
Probably going to see a cooler winter this year, so I'm wondering if that pattern is going to explode.
Yeah, so I guess, look, the bottom line of this is that I don't think we know whether or not the NAO is likely to be more in a positive state or more in a negative state. The models certainly don't get the dynamics right, and they don't. The standard sea-level climate models, they don't include what seem to be the critical dynamical processes. Not least because they don't have good representations of the stratosphere, and you could see how the stratosphere was critical to the response.
Thanks. We better. Can we just leave the other two questions? Thanks. So our final speaker is Michael Wehner.
So I'm going to talk about some high-resolution simulations that we're doing at Berkeley that are tailored towards the 1.5 and 2 degree question, but more generally about a series of simulations led by our fearless session chair here, Dan Mitchell, called Happy. This is the photograph I took up in Aaron last weekend, beautiful spot. And also, the next slide, I have some results, some preliminary results from Hideo Shiogama, who would have liked to have been here, but he couldn't be. All the simulations results I'm going to show you are very, very preliminary. I declared my simulations done on Saturday, and I got the last numbers yesterday. I've never cut a presentation site so close to the wire as this one, so you'll bear with me. Next slide, please. So the question being asked here is, are there relevant simulations? Miles has asked this question, and Dan has come up with an answer, and all the rest of these people also believe the same, that there aren't relevant simulations for a stabilized climate. We have lots of transient simulations, but not a series of custom designed, as it were, simulations to answer the questions that posed by this conference. And so there's a paper called Half a Degree Additional Warming Prognosis and Projected Impacts, which is also the name of the project, HAPPY for short. It's currently in review, public review, at Geoscience Model Development. At this website, you're welcome to go out to read it and comment.
Make nice comments.
So keep Dan busy. Next slide, please. So this is a slide Dan showed yesterday when we met as a group. Asking why do we need HAPPY, and there are many reasons, I think. A lot has to do with the way the ocean lags, the ocean temperature response to increased CO2 lags that of the land, so that when you select out a global mean of say 1.5 degrees from an RCP 8.5 simulation, that's not going to be the same as a stabilized climate. It's probably a little warmer over land for that global mean temperature. But what he showed here is a very interesting result, that the hydrological cycle takes quite a long time to equilibrate. The blue dots are from RCP 2.6 and the red from RCP 8.5. The vertical axis is precipitation change, the horizontal is temperature change. And you can see that it does not give the same answer for the response globally to the changes in precipitation if you just were to read it out of the transient simulation. So hence the desire to have a multi-model experiment, numerical experiment, that we can draw some conclusions about 1.5 degrees. Next slide, please. This experiment is very different than CMIP experiments in some ways, but it's very similar to what we know as AMIP. It's an imposed temperature. So CMIP experiments are imposed emissions or imposed concentrations of greenhouse gases, and you get the temperature you get. Here we go, it's more constrained. We impose a global mean 1.5 degree change, or the ocean pattern that would lead to that. There are a number of models, go back please. There are a number of models participating, 8 models from 7 groups, 2 from ours, most of them around 100 kilometers or a little coarser, and then one, we have one of those, and then at Berkeley, and then also a 25 kilometer run. Next one, please. This is, that didn't come out. These are the imposed sea surface temperatures for the two experiments of 1.5 and 2 degrees. Next slide, please. This is the movie. Can you see if it'll, if you click on the movie, if it'll run? So this is total precipitable water. If you were an astronaut, you could see in this space what you would see. Now, for those of you in the back, this might look kind of fuzzy. But what you should see, notice, is that there are lots of very intense storms here. 25 kilometers is a threshold breakthrough kind of resolution where intense weather looks much more realistic. It makes hurricanes. It makes very strong extratropical cyclones, mid-latitude storms. I believe it makes mesoscale convective systems or things that look like that, although we haven't quantified it, realistic atmospheric rivers. Now, could you just pause that maybe? Hold on. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. The other one was the 200 kilometer version of the same model. By and large, it looks the same there you go. So, you know, if you're in the back, it probably does look the same. But up front, you'll see there's a lot more structure to it. So the large-scale pattern at 100 or 200 kilometers of the CMIP 5 class resolution is fine, which is great, because we make a lot of conclusions from the IPCC about large-scale climate change. You know, that this high-resolution models don't dispute any of that. But they allow us to get at the finer scales. Next slide, please. So just to convince you that these hurricanes in there are real, we've counted them over a period of 1979 to 2005. The average is around 85. The model just happened to get that. It actually turns out to be tunable. I didn't tune it. Here's a more stringent test, which is a scatter plot of the maximum wind speed versus the minimum pressure over for each of the storms over a long simulation. Blue is is the real world, or an estimate of it, the orange is the model. And the interesting thing about this particular model is it makes storms all the way up to category 5. It doesn't make quite enough, but it makes them. And so that's kind of what I would expect. You know, it's not 25 kilometers, still pretty coarse for a hurricane. Next slide, please. So here's the answer, that a warmer climate makes fewer hurricanes. Now, this may not be what you've read. And I have another paper where I show that conclusions about hurricane frequency drawn from CMIP 5 class models are inherently flawed. And the reason for it is that when I run the 100 kilometer version of this model, it only makes 8 per year instead of 85. And indeed, in a warmer climate, it makes more than 8. It makes like 10 or 12, depending on how warm I make it. And the reason for that is it's only seeing actually the tail of the distribution. And in fact, in the high resolution model, it makes more category 4 and 5 simulations. So a direct comparison of hurricane counts from CMIP 5 class models is going to give you the wrong answers, give you the wrong sign. Furthermore, other more sophisticated methodologies where you look at things like the cyclone genesis potential would give you the same answer. And what's interesting, the reason that it actually makes fewer, what I believe, is that a warmer climate is more stable. And so even though the cyclogenesis potential is higher, so the potential for making hurricanes and tropical cyclones is larger, it goes unrealized because there are fewer disturbances passing through the cyclogenesis regions because of the warmer, the more stable atmosphere, both more stable because of changes in the vertical lapse rate, but also in the equator to pole gradient. Next slide. And so here's sort of the punchline for this meeting is that the most intense storms, and this is a much more robust result across other models of this class and even the coarser models, the most intense storms become more intense. So in order to show that, what I did here is I took the strongest storm globally for every year, and I did the average of that for each of these simulations. What I have here is something of the what the model produced for the present. This is the 1.5 degree simulation. This is a 2 degree simulation that's not quite apples to apples comparison, but it's what I have at the moment. And then an RCP 8.5 end of the century simulation. You can see there's a steady march upward in the average most intense storm. Now the very most intense storms are even stronger. And by the time you get to 2 degrees, and I don't have enough runs at 1.5 to show this, you actually would go over the scale of 85 meters per second. Now some of us have been proposing that we actually need a new category for the Saffir-Simpson scale, and that category 6 is probably, and maybe 7, are really necessary additions to the way we describe hurricanes to the public. Now, one of the things you have to remember about this is that the models, stronger storms are a little weaker than the real storms because of resolution constraints, and so that would easily push us into the category 6. Next slide, please. I did a brief analysis of temperature, changes in annual mean and changes in annual maximum at 1.5 degrees on the two slides. It's sort of, you've seen one of these, you've seen them all. There's a poleward enhancement of warming in the mean, but a land-ocean enhancement in the extreme. This is relative to present day, so add another degree for what it actually is pre-industrial. So you're up around 3, 4 to 5 degrees warmer for the annual maximum temperature. Next slide, please. This is a result from Hideo. Hideo has run his model, the MIROC model. He has 100 realizations of each one done. He hasn't released them yet because it's still early days, and there have been some hiccups along the way. This is a 100-kilometer model. It's a very good model for its class, and he shows that this would then be this is relative to the pre-industrial, so the present-day change, and then the 1.5 degree change. And I have to talk to him about what this really means. But what I see in this for RX one day, which is the rainiest day of the year, is that at this scale, the Clausius-Clapeyron scaling is quite adequate. Next slide, please. So in my conclusions, a 1.5 degree warmer world is not a safe world. Now, I don't think anybody at this conference would say such things, but it's said all the time that this is the safe amount of climate change. I'm sorry, that train has left the station. And a 1.5 degree world is more intense tropical cyclones, substantially hotter heat waves, and more precipitation. But we know all this already because event attribution, which is a discipline on developing discipline unto itself, has shown that these things have already happened. Next little button. It's just all worse at 1.5 degrees than it is now. 2 degrees is worse than that. 3 degrees is worse than that. You know, this isn't rocket science. So thank you. Next slide. That's my address. I'll take questions.
That's yet. We'll go
later. Thanks very much. Thank you. Do you think basin differences yet, or is that just?
I have not. And in order to look at basin differences, we're going to have to do a lot more runs. That's why I did not show any changes in precipitation from my runs, because they're too noisy. It doesn't make any sense. We just got our proposal renewed, so HAPI is now a funded project within our proposal. One of the things the review committee asked me to do was estimate how much computer time we're gonna need. We asked for 1 billion processor hours over the next 3 years, which sounds like a lot, because it is. So we will be able to do many simulations. How many depends a lot on my ability to tolerate moving petabytes of data around.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Do you see any evidence of changes in sea level in the Arctic
I see a little bit, and I would see more if I had more simulations, I believe. What I do see is that the average time that a storm spends at category 1, for instance, is longer. And at category 4, it's about a half, in a 2 degree world, I only know about the 2 degree. In the 2 degree world, it's about a half a day longer in the intense category, that's quarter 4 and 5, and about a day and a half, or maybe a day, at category 1, and category 0, tropical storm, is almost 2 days longer. So the question I asked myself was, does that mean that the storms are moving slower? Because, you know, I made this claim about the warmer world being more stable. And the answer is no, they move at the same speed. But the region that can support tropical cyclone speeds in terms of the sea surface temperature, which is like 26 centigrade or something, expands. And so whether the cyclogenesis changes, I cannot say. But certainly storms do their tropical to extratropical transition at a higher latitude. I think that's probably the best way to say it.
Any more questions yet, Brenda?
I think this is fascinating. I just was wondering, for in terms of categories of hurricanes are really not useful because of storm surge and other activities. The Carey manual suggested the accumulated cyclone index, which accumulated. So when you do that, usually the cube of the wind speed of the over the aerial extent, a lot of these are affecting more of the ocean because you can get much bigger storm surge. And so when you compare that metric, have you seen a shift?
This is on my to-do list. I have not. I don't like the Saffir-Simpson scale any more than you do. But it is the way we communicate to the public, and I don't see that changing anytime soon. It's kind of like the Richter scale. It's got its flaws. You know, it's what it is. But no, it's a really interesting question. What I would expect is that accumulated cyclonic energy would show a significant increase, even at 1.5 degrees. Now, one thing I didn't say, and this is hopefully something we're going to do in the HAPI project, is look at the pattern of climate change, because especially at the basin scale, what happens at the small scales matters, and especially how the equator to pole gradient changes.
One final question, Chris.
These are SST driven experiments.
They're aimed for the future.
So they wouldn't have the impact of the ocean mixing into the ocean and the heat loss into the ocean to affect the storm track and the power dissipation index.
Yeah, you know, that's an interesting question, and there was some work by one of our postdocs who's since moved on, so it's not finished, where he coupled a mixed layer ocean to the same model, and you get a nice cold wake through these Cat 4 and Cat 5s, but the preliminary results were that the peak speed were not affected particularly as much as I would have thought. Because yes, the ocean is an infinite heat source, so in an AMIPS experiment.
Thank you very much, Michael.
Thank you.